Thank you for tuning in to the Message Podcast. If you don't know by now, you can find our podcast on YouTube under the Message on WCDB. Otherwise, you can tune in live every Monday from 6 to 8 p.m. while we broadcast from the studios of WCDB Albany 90.9 FM. Enjoy the show.
Believe it or not, there was this band back in the late 60s and early 70s called the Delfonics, and this is their original song, Ready or Not, from 1968. With that, we'd like to welcome you to another edition of the Message Podcast. The question today is, what exactly happens to a band like the Delfonics in modern times? Here to answer that question and many more, one-time member of the Delfonics, Freddy Ingleton. Thank you for coming on, Freddie.
You found it all right?
I found it okay. WCDB Radio.
Yeah. Yep. Is this your first time up here on the in the radio station?
No, Nick. I've been on this station, I believe this would be my third time.
Okay. And you were on Sir Walford's show, I guess? Is that what you were on?
That's correct. I believe it was on a Saturday.
Great.
Saturdays, nice. R&B station.
Yeah. Well, so what's a former Delfonics member doing in Albany? I guess is the first question.
Did you grow up here in Albany or no?
No, I was born in the Midwest, okay. St. Louis, Missouri. And 3 years later, my family moved to New York City.
Okay, yeah.
So I was raised in New York City and Queens.
Nice.
To answer your question, Connor, during the years, there's been a bunch of groups from Universal Attractions Booking Agency called the 70s Soul Jam. We used to sing in Albany at the Palace Theater.
Okay.
And 2010, well, at that time, I joined Blue Magic, another R&B soul group.
Yeah.
I had left the Delfonics one with Blue Magic. I met a lady.
It's always a love story, isn't
that,
it?
That was it, a lady.
that's a good enough reason for me.
And then, so the Delfonics, they're based out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. What's the story with you coming down from New York and ending up with a group from Philadelphia?
Okay, the Delfonics. my first favorite group. As soon as I seen them at the theater, I was about 11 years old. 11 or 12. I wanted to be like them. So guess what? I made my mama buy all their records.
There you go.
I sang them songs for years until I auditioned for them.
What year was that?
1996, a successful audition.
So this was later on. They were a group from the 60s and 70s, but they were playing music continually up until, you know, when did they stop really making music, the Delfonics?
William Hart, the owner and original lead singer.
Yeah, and then was
and
it his,
songwriter.
Was it his brother, Wilbert? Or is that his cousin?
His brother wrote some songs as well, Wilbert.
Okay.
William Hart, he had the pretty voice. He wrote a lot of hits. Lala Means I Love You.
I know that one.
Ready or Not, Here I Come.
Great songs.
A lot of people followed behind the Delfonics. They was the first Philadelphia soul group.
Yeah.
And a lot of groups followed behind them. They were trendsetters.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, a lot of groups followed behind the Delfonics. Blue Magic, the Stylistics, on and on. A lot of people like to re-record their songs. The Jackson 5, the Fugees, they did Ready or Not, you know.
Yeah. Todd Rundgren, Prince.
Prince.
Yeah, so many people.
Lots of people.
Patti LaBelle.
That's right, Patti LaBelle.
So I guess, like, what was it like playing, like, with essentially what was your idol, like, your idol group, like, growing up? What was it like collaborating with them?
I feel it was like a spiritual time when I auditioned for them. And I remember getting out of my car. It was like a navy blue Mazda with a sunroof. And I had on the colors red, white, and blue. And I was getting out of my car, getting ready to close the door. He was standing in the doorway in the driveway. He said, "I don't even know this guy, and I like him already. I like his spirit." And I had on like him, like a Stetson. Like the gangster hats back in the day. And so I started singing, and he taught me harmony. I was always a lead singer, but he said, "Freddy, I'm going to teach you harmony. And once you learn that, you'll become a better singer."
And that was important to the Delfonics because they did a lot of harmonizing.
Yes, it was one of the best harmonizing groups of all time. Superior harmony.
Yeah, definitely.
And I would just want to add that that record, Lala Means I Love You, was an international hit.
Yeah. I mean,
in
they
a very short time. And through history, they said a lot of babies was made off of that record.
So did you meet, you knew William Hart, Wilbert Hart, Greg Hill, Solomon Love, and Joe Brands? Those guys were all in the group at one point or another, right?
There was a split at some point. And the brothers, William and Wilbur and Randy, those were the three originals.
Okay.
Randy left, and then
Randy Kane.
Major Harris joined the Delfonics. Mm. After that, there was a split, and then there was the two brothers had a group, you know, of their own.
Oh, okay, I didn't know that.
So this is interesting. I auditioned for Wilbert Hart at first, but I got a phone call later and auditioned for the other brother. I wound up with William, the original lead singer.
And what was that audition process like?
Okay, they needed a second tenor. I said, I never sang second tenor. But I wasn't going to miss the opportunity.
Yeah.
I tried to, Nick and Connor, sing every voice level that I could.
Yeah.
First tenor, second tenor, and baritone. I also sang bass for my college.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So wide range
Where
of
was that
vocal
at?
Abilities.
Where was that college at?
My college, I went to Westchester Community College.
Oh, okay.
That was a part of SUNY.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's in Valhalla, New York, Westchester County.
Valhalla.
Yeah, near White Plains.
Okay.
Very good. I had two very good professors to teach voice.
Yeah. Would you say, like, they really helped you get along, like, in your musical career, or, yeah?
Absolutely. One was a maestro, Professor Leonti.
Nice.
And Professor Gardner, she taught voice, too. How to sing properly and breathe, always warm up.
Yeah.
And I took that class 3 times and got an A. They said, you're a natural.
Yeah.
I said, thank you. And, well... You know how it all started?
How did it all start?
First grade?
From first grade, fellas.
Okay.
Explain that.
Living in New York City, right, on 67th Street. Across the street was Channel 5. And then 2 blocks down was my public school, elementary. They loved to sing, so they had glee clubs. I was part of the glee club, and at one point, the principal says, we need one student from the entire school to sing, you know, for the graduates, the community, and the staff. I want the best singer from each class to report to the auditorium. I didn't know it was going to be me.
That was first grade?
Yeah, so I...
Wow.
I was the best singer in the school, and see, they made that known.
Yeah. Huh.
And the teacher's playing piano behind me as I'm singing.
What did you sing for them?
Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, lovely.
Huh.
Yeah, with a French tam on my head.
Huh,
awesome. You know, with a bow tie on and the Bermuda awesome. Shorts with just, the sandals.
Just little Freddy Ingleton in first grade.
That was my first gig.
That's awesome. I guess we should transition. What are you up to right now? I know we were talking a little bit about your like solo career right now and your recording. Can you give us an update on what you're up to?
First of all, I want to thank God for giving me the gift to sing and to write lyrics. Mm. I go down to the riverfront here, and I pull out my pad and my pen, fellas, you know, and it just starts flowing. I wrote Butterfly and Bert Price. I believe he's a musical genius. He composed the music for me, arranged it.
Okay.
After that, I did On the Case, Something About You, 8 songs on this CD, and I'm working on 3 more.
Great stuff. Do you play like live gigs still, or?
Yes. I also want it to be known. I have a music scholarship program at Schenectady College.
Huh.
And every year, a college student majoring in music, they get the Freddy Ingleton Award. And I'm very happy to have a scholarship funding my name.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
And I usually sing up there every year for Black History Month.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I would like to do? Sing here.
At U Albany?
I would like to if you have Black History Month.
Yeah, we definitely do.
Yes.
Yeah, we have like some sort of awareness for that. Yeah.
When did you get that scholarship in your name? How long has that been going on for?
Let's see. I believe since 2012.
Okay.
Right.
So just to give like a little overview of the Delfonics, they've been on the top 10 in 1969. They're in U.S. R&B top. They're number 8 on the charts. They're also number 4 in 1970 with another song. They're always in the top 10 for those... they're in the top 100 for those 4 years in the 70s. So, yeah, they've really been... You know, they're pretty acclaimed, you know? Have you ever... When you auditioned for them, did you kind of feel nervous almost? Or did you feel like this was meant to be? Like, I feel natural with these guys.
You know what? I'm glad you asked that, Nick. It just happened naturally. I believe things happen spiritually and then physically. Mm. And
kind of just fell right into place?
Yes.
Huh.
Naturally, it just came and it developed. We started singing, This Is Your Note. They call it blending. You could be a good singer, right? But not the right singer for a group.
If it doesn't match, if it doesn't blend.
Right. So blending is very important. I blended with those guys. And he said, you know what? I really like this blend better than the cats that I'm singing with now.
Yeah.
And then he, boom, I'm on an airplane flying to guess where?
Where?
Los Angeles?
St. Louis, Missouri, where I was born. That was my first show. Where it all started. This thing was wow, blew my mind, like the record they wrote.
So I can see how it's kind of like a spiritual thing for you because, you know, your first show ever with these guys was your hometown.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's pretty crazy.
How'd it go? How'd the show go?
Wow, it was a great show. And then I didn't know about all that security business. They said, uh-oh, he went out front to go, you know, past the, you know, boundary, and they had the things in their ears. Or security.
Oh, my God.
Go get him.
Bring him back.
They made a big deal out of it. I just wanted to get a soda or something, a drink.
Yeah.
So how old were you when you started playing with the Delfonics? That was 96, you said.
I was 39. Today, I'm 61 years old.
Hmm. What brings you back? What brings you up to Albany now?
It was a lady, you know. After I sang.
Right. Yep, sorry.
When I sang at the Palace Theater, that night it was the Stylistics, Blue Magic, who I'm a part of, the Emotions. These are all the famous groups from the 70s, and they had a lot of hit records. I say it's about five different groups. That night we went to the Albany Hotel, which is now the Hilton Hotel.
Okay.
And they had a big celebration there called the Black Caucus.
Yep.
That's where I met my girl, Lori.
Wow.
And guess what?
What?
I wrote a song about us that's on that CD. It's called I Found Me a Girl.
Oh, okay. That's track number two.
Oh, we'll definitely
it's
play
about,
that
it's
one.
It's a true story.
Yeah.
We're going to play that one probably when we wrap things up.
Sure.
But, yeah, so La La Means I Love You was number four in 1968, and then number two in the U.S. R&B. So, I mean, these guys were kind of heavy hitters, which is, you know, it's crazy. Are you still in contact with any of these old members?
Actually, not.
Well, Kane passed away, didn't he?
Oh, Randy. We was good friends. And, yeah, Randy, you know, he spoke with me. He passed away. Also, Major Harris, he's a former member. He helped me with my singing career.
Mm-hmm.
And William helped me with my singing career. William was the one who gave me my start. And there was another Delfonic at the time named Salam Love.
Yep.
He seen some, you know, development in me.
Yeah. Were you the youngest member?
Yes.
You were. So these guys were all pretty old because you were listening to them when you were, what, 11, you said?
Mm-hmm.
And they were all grown men at that point, right? Or,
yeah, William was 9 years older than me.
Yeah. Wow.
And I wanted to be like him.
It's 20 so years old.
When you hear this CD that I wrote, the songs, it has a... I shaped my voice from their style.
Yeah.
You know, what I loved about the Delfonics, they had a style of their own.
Yeah.
Originality.
Pioneering.
Yes. And they used to come out with the capes, like Batman, you know, come out with the capes on the first song.
Yeah, they're stylish.
And they had like a Spanish style of dressing. William used to like the... you know, back in the days of Zorro, how they dressed.
Yeah. Mm. And did they have dance. Spanish, like, ethnicities? Like, where did the influence come from? They were just interested in it?
I think when they was touring around the world, you know, when they performed in Spain, they took on that style later on.
Huh. How about that? Did you ever wear a cape?
Oh, a lot of times.
Yeah?
Yes.
That's awesome.
Nice.
So you played with the Delfonics, 96, and... since then, how many years did you actually play with them? Record albums? How many albums were recorded?
I've sang on one album.
Okay.
And a lot of DVD clips.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All over the country.
You mean like live tapings of shows and stuff? Oh, that's interesting.
Yes.
Nice.
My biggest show I've ever done inside was where the Phoenix Suns play basketball.
Oh, wow, the stadium.
And that holds 18,000 seats. And that show was sold out. So that's the biggest audience I ever sang in front of on the inside.
How did that feel?
Wow. Well, you know, I was ready for it. You know, you have to develop yourself to connect with the people. And you know what? Since you asked me that, each place that you perform at, you get a different feel from the audience. The audience might be distant. It makes you feel like you got to work harder.
Yeah.
Some audiences, they're up close on you. They're screaming and clapping and enjoying the music and the show.
It's a symbiotic relationship. You guys work off of one another.
Yes.
Hmm. And so you also played with this group called Blue Magic. Were there any other groups that you played with throughout your whole life?
I've had other offers. The Blue Notes, the Intruders, Cuba Gooding, who sang with the Main Ingredient. His son is an actor.
Yeah, Junior.
Yeah, his father. I've done a lot of shows with his father in the same shows, but
wow.
He asked me a few times to sing with him. I've had other offers from the Dramatics and other artists, groups. But I, for some strong reason, I was searching for myself.
Yeah. Don't we always do that through music?
I wanted to develop a style of my own, fellas, you know.
And is that what you think you accomplished with On the Case?
Yes.
Are you still writing and working on any more songs, like in the future? Can we expect something else?
Oh, absolutely. Listen, I was just telling Connor a little while ago, I'm working on 3 new songs. One is about an angel. It's called Dream Angel. When you go to sleep, an angel's watching you. An angel loves you. And then the next day you walking down the street, hey, that's the angel from my dream. The lovely lady I just met. Mm. Dream Angel, what else? Come Back. That's another love song. We Were Meant to Be. Yeah, there's more to come.
You have a big heart then. A lot of your songs are about, you know, romance and love and kind of spiritual things like you were saying. So, huh.
Yeah, I think we're going to be wrapping up here in a few minutes. But, Freddie, you have anything else to add?
Anything that we may have missed over that you want to include? Or, you know,
yes.
It's all you.
Been such a great guest.
Well, I want to thank you guys for inviting me on the radio station. And,
thank you for coming.
I'd like to also add that Motown inspired me too when I was a kid, you know, the Temptations.
Definitely.
And Smokey Robinson. And as I've gotten older, my life has become more spiritual. And I wrote a God song, fellas, and it's called God Won't Let You Down.
Mm-hmm.
I believe he lives in the heart of every soul.
Yeah.
And that's another nice song. In fact, I sang it yesterday.
Huh.
Nice.
You know, people put pressure on you when they see, hey, you going to sing a song today, buddy?
Yeah, sing a song. I mean, we're going to put that pressure on you when we bring you back on, I think. Yeah, I think we're going to have you sing for us when we bring you back on sometime, if that's fine with you.
You know, I would love to. Next time I come on,
yeah.
I'm very happy to have 2 bright young fellas interview me at Albany University.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Freddie. Guys, that was Freddy Ingleton. We're going to play a couple of his songs right now from his newest album, On the Case. That is your newest album, right?
Yes, sir.
Yep. And what year did that come out? I don't know if I asked.
This year.
This year. Okay, great. Well, you're going to hear a couple songs from his new album, On the Case. And, thanks for listening, guys. That was Freddy Ingleton from the Delfonics. Thanks for coming on, Freddie.
Thank you.
So goes the 3rd episode of the Message Podcast. Once again, a post-production project Nick Muscavige and I, Connor Murphy, have taken upon ourselves. It originally comes from the studios of WCDB Albany 90.9 FM. You can hear our live interviews, news, and analysis every Monday from 6 to 8 p.m. A huge thanks to our guest Freddy Ingleton for making this interview possible. And as always, a big thanks to our executive music producer Marsh Sound for his intro track Oceans and the outro track Space Op. So in recognition of Freddy's current work, here's the title track from his latest album, On the Case. Enjoy.